Hallelujah. I just want to, hallelujah, welcome you on this morning. Hallelujah. Just want to welcome you, hallelujah, to Progressive Life Worship and Training Center. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I am Elder Chris Gray. Hallelujah. We welcome you on behalf of the shepherds of this house, Apostles Lawrence and Dorothy Govan. Amen. Amen. And God is good. Amen. God is truly good. He's faithful. Hallelujah. And I'm just excited for what he's going to do on today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are in post-resurrection. Hallelujah. We are in post-resurrection. Hallelujah. There's some awesome things going on, and I'm just glad, hallelujah, that we're able to be a part of it. Amen. Amen. There are some that want to be in the house on this morning, but they just can't be. Hallelujah. They can't be. Hallelujah. So we stand in the gap for them on this morning. Amen. And God is just so awesome. Amen. And what he's doing. Amen. God spoke to me on this morning. Amen. And I woke up and I wanted to start worshiping. Amen. And the Lord said, you know what? Don't turn on any music on this morning. Amen. He said, I just want some alone time. Amen. And I just want to speak to you on this morning. Amen. And tell you some things. Amen. And we just had some alone time as I was preparing, as I was on my way to church. Amen. And the Lord dropped a word in my spirit on this morning. Amen. And it was actually pre-resurrection. Amen. But it's a relevant word. Amen. And if you would just hear me out on this morning. Amen. And it comes from the book of John. Amen. The book of John on this morning, the first chapter. Amen. And I'm going to go down to the 43rd verse. Amen. And if you would just hear me out on this morning, amen. And John 1:43 says, the following day Jesus wanted to go to Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, follow me. Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. And so Philip found Nathanael and said to him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And Nathanael said to him, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Does it make sense for me to go to church? What is this Jesus that you speak of? What can he do for me? See, we've heard this, can anything good come out of Nazareth before, amen. And Philip said to him, come and see. And so the word that the Lord had for me on this morning is just come and see. Come and see. I don't know what you're looking for on this morning, hallelujah. But the Lord said, just come and see. Just come and see what I have for you. Just give me a chance, hallelujah, and let me show you some things. And Philip was able to say this because he already knew what the Lord had done for him. He already knew that the Lord had found him, hallelujah. So I know what the Lord has done for me. Glory to God. And all I want to tell you on this morning, hallelujah, for those that are in the house, for those that are online, is come and see. Just give them a chance on this morning. Hallelujah. Just open your ears on this morning. Just open your heart. I'm not the preacher. Hallelujah. The word is coming forth. Hallelujah. But the prophetic word is come and see. I know what he's done for me. I know where he brought me from. Just come and see. Glory to God. So, Lord, we just bless you on this morning, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, just for who you are, Lord God. We thank you, oh God, that you're with us on this morning, oh God. We thank you, oh God, for those that are in the house, oh God. We thank you for those that are online, oh God. We're asking, oh God, that you would speak, oh God, as only you can speak, oh God. That you would touch us supernaturally, oh God. We open ourselves to you on this morning, oh God. We open our eyes, we open our ears, we open our hearts, oh God. We're asking, oh God, that you would come in, oh God, not only to this place, oh God, but come into our hearts, oh God, and do a work in your people on this morning, oh God. That you would touch us, oh God, wherever we are, oh God. That you would comfort us, oh God, for those that need comfort, oh God, that you would strengthen, oh God, those that need strength on this morning, oh God, that you would bring peace, oh God, for those that need peace on this morning, oh God. We declare, oh God, that all things are in you, oh God, that you can do everything but fail, oh God, and we place our trust and our faith in you on this morning, oh God. We don't know how you're going to do it, oh God, but we're glad, oh God, to be a part, oh God, of what you're doing, oh God. Oh God, so we're asking that you would have your way, oh God, that you would move by your spirit, oh God, in this house, oh God, in all the earth, oh God, that you would use, oh God, the one that is coming to minister, oh God, like never before, oh God, that you would speak, oh God, through her, oh God, as only you can, oh God. Oh God, and we're asking these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. 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 And so we're going to have Apostle Lawrence come up on this morning, oh God, and open us up in worship. And then the next voice you will hear will be that of Apostle Dorothy Govan. Glory to God.
Amen. All right. Come and see. Oh, my God. That's a serious, serious. I say, that's a serious evangelist word right there. So simple. That's why I say that's an easy one. Everybody should grab on to that one. Somebody should debate with you or talk to you about the Lord. Wait a minute. Just come and see. I know most everybody curious. You know, we got a lot of Thomases. I don't believe till I see. Good. I'm glad you need to see something because God can show you anything you want to see. We have a mighty God. Yeah, if that's what you need, look, I love it. He did it for Thomas. Thomas said, I'm not going to believe until I see. He said, now, blessed are those that have not seen. But if that's what you need, he said, I'll do that for you. Amen. So come and see. Because we'll come and see Jesus. That's what we want to come see. Because he's the one that's going to do it for us. Amen. So I'm going to sing this song, and I hope it encouraged you this morning, because that's what we believe in, Jesus. Amen. It's Jesus we believe in. Amen.
Impossible is your reality. Jesus, I believe. Jesus, I believe, yes. So let your kingdom come, and let your will be done here on earth, just like it is in heaven. God, let your kingdom come and let your will be done right here on earth, just like it is in heaven. I need to hear you now. I need to know it's you. I'm standing on your promises. I know your words are true. You're bigger than what I see. You ain't changed for me. 'Cause even the impossible is your reality. I need to hear you now. I know that it's true. Standing on your promises, I know your words are true. You're bigger than what I see in exchange for me. 'Cause even the impossible is your reality. God, even your impossible is your reality. Jesus, I believe. Jesus, I believe. Help my unbelief, God. Jesus, I believe. Jesus, I believe.
Come on and bless him. Hallelujah. Oh, we got to believe. We got to believe. Hallelujah. That's all we have is our belief. Amen. We got to believe. I thank God. Amen. For I don't know, like I said before, I don't know if I can follow those two guys. Amen. I want to just sit back and come and tell somebody, just come on and see, amen, what God is doing. I thank God for all of you this morning. I want to honor God. Thank you, man of God, amen. I thank God for what a wonderful song, amen. I thank God for Pastor Lawrence, amen, and how he is able, amen. That brother got a repertoire of songs in his heart, amen. And I thank God for him and being able to just set up the atmosphere for what God want to do. And I thank God. I honor God for Apostle being in the house. Amen. Apostle Zen White is here. Amen. I don't know why I said, you know what, when I saw him sitting in, I said, now, that's a setup. Every time I have to preach, he shows up. Amen. Amen. I said, I think he got his eyes on me. Amen. And I'm supposed to be doing what I'm supposed to do. But I thank God. Every time he come, I try to be doing what you ordained me to do. Amen. Thank God for you, for all of our visitors. Amen. Good to see you. Amen. Good to see you. Amen. I see that woman of God over there. Who is that right there? Amen. That's your mama. I can tell. Amen. You look just like her. Amen. Amen. I thank God for you, Mama, being in the house today. Amen. Make sure you see me so I can tell you what I need to tell you on your daughter. Okay. All right. All right. I bless the Lord. Amen. I love to see mamas when they come. Amen. Tammy. Mama Mac, I got something to tell you about Tammy, okay? I got something to tell you, all right? Amen, amen. I love when the mamas show up, amen, so I can tell on them daughters, amen, and them sons. I thank God for all of you. And I want to just thank God for the season that we're in, amen? Amen. Yeah. Ella Chris, one thing I am so proud of in this house. I bless God for all of our online listeners. Amen. For those of you, our members that are far and near, we send greetings to you. We ask you to get yourself ready, get your devices, get some paper, some pencils, get in the glory of the Lord, because what God has to say. And I want to just start off by saying I am one of the pastors here. So if I don't get to but a piece of this, can I come back? Amen. Can I come back again? Amen. Would you allow me? Sometimes our apostle said to us, he said, sometimes y'all try to put too much in one. He said, sometimes you need to just stay with one thing. Stay right there until God releases you. Amen. So I want to just say that I may not get through, because this is a heavy subject that I have today, and God gave it to me. And even if people say that I'm off track, I know what the Lord says. And one thing I have practiced doing is hearing the voice of God. I may miss him every now and then, but most often when I get, I'm like Elder Chris, when I get in a quiet moment and get in the presence of the Lord, he just starts speaking, and maybe other folks don't believe. And I even have someone who questioned, said, I don't believe God speaks. I said, sweetie, you should have told me that a while back. Amen. Because I know too much about the conversation that God and I have had. And every time we have that conversation, he seemed to be right every time. I don't know how he does it, but he is right all the time. Amen. The more I think I know, the less I know, and the more he knows. Amen. And so I don't make an excuse anymore for those who don't believe. Amen. I love what Pastor said, help my unbelief. I heard Chris say, come and see for yourself. Amen. Amen. Because the same person that told me they didn't believe that God speak, and I just kept on talking, Pastor. I just kept on talking after a while, and I just started asking. I said, well, you know, can I ask you a question? I want to know, could you tell me why so-and-so and so? She said, who told you that? I said, I just want to know. Does that resonate in your spirit at all? She said, who told you? Who been telling my business? Who been telling my business? I said, God. God will tell our business every time. Amen. You don't even want some things you say, God, I thought that was between me. God said, no, because you were hiding in pride. And so I had to release that so that you would deal with that. Amen. So that's not what I'm talking about this morning. But I bless God. We are in what Elder Chris said, post-resurrection. And one thing about this church, we are prophetic people, and we listen for the time and seasons that we're in, because we try to look at what was so that we can understand what is. Is that all right? And so you will hear us. You will hear our presiders, our singers, our worship. You will hear us flow from a prophetic standpoint. And that's nothing deep, except we have turned our ears to hear, and we believe that the Spirit of the Lord will reveal certain things to us. And when it's revealed to us, then we are responsible. Here's the other side of the prophetic. We are responsible when the revelation comes, is not only to obey it, but to help somebody else to understand that same revelation. There are two sides to the prophetic. Everybody want to run around and get a word, but do you not know that the stronger part of the prophetic is being able to get a word and then give it out? Okay, so people that's all prophetic and all they want you to do is come to them for a word that they want to talk to. No, sometimes the word has to start with us. Is that all right? It begins, anybody that prophesied to you, they have had an experience with the divine in order to know his voice. My sheep. That they know. See, you got to understand the knowing there has to do with I have an intimate relationship. Did you hear Elder Chris describe that? My intimate relationship is that God can tell me, I don't want music today. Amen. I want you. I want your mind. I want your mind to be on me and not on the music. I want some quiet time. I want some intimate time. I want you to get to know me. Ooh, I ain't even opened my Bible yet, and I'm preaching. Amen. I ain't even opened my Bible yet, but I need you to understand, because post-resurrection is a time that there are a lot of, and I love what you did. You said pre-resurrection. That's all right. Amen. Because there, you got to look at pre, post, and future. You deep, man. You didn't even know. Amen. When we talk about the resurrection season, you have to look at pre. What did Jesus do before he went to the cross? Amen. You look at the cross, the crucifixion. Last week we celebrated Resurrection Sunday. We know that everything that God said, Pastor just sang about, I believe, because everything you said, all I got to do is stand on your promises, because everything you said, you did it. Come on, y'all. Remember? Everything that he prophesied, everything he told his disciples, even though they didn't understand it, he told them, and everything he told them came to pass. And he was able to remind them on resurrection morning, didn't I say that I was going down? Didn't I say that I was going to be crucified? Didn't I say that 3 days will make a day? Did I not say that? And so the resurrection is a time that you can see a lot about your Savior. Somebody said, my Savior. You can see a lot and learn a lot about our Savior through resurrection season. So I tell people all the time, resurrection didn't stop. Resurrection did not end last Sunday night. I'm going to even say it like this. Resurrection didn't end when Easter Sunday was over. Amen. If you don't have a current, if you don't realize that resurrection is a lifestyle, come on. If you don't realize that Jesus is alive, not just Sunday morning, but I can feel him on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. If you don't realize that Jesus is alive and in us, amen, and that he leads and guides and direct and order and take care of us and provide and cover us, and the blood, the name, the worth, oh my God, if you don't realize all of the makeup of resurrection, baby, you just a person that came to church on Sunday. But for the rest of us, we live resurrection every day. Come on, somebody. We live resurrection every day. How do you live resurrection every day? When I wake up in the morning and the glory of the Lord begin to shine over me, when I wake up in the morning, I can feel his presence. When I go to bed at night and he is with me. When I drive my car and I know I'm not alone. Somebody said resurrection. Oh, people want to belittle. People want to downplay. Oh, you go to church. You went to church on Resurrection Sunday? Yeah. Oh, I didn't make it on Resurrection Sunday. Maybe I'll make it next year. Boo. You don't need to wait till next year. Come on. I'm going to need you to get the vision now. I'm going to need you to know Sunday is over, but resurrection is still going on. Amen. Oh, Elder Chris said, Pastor, open your Bible. Open your Bible. Open your Bible, Pastor. Amen. And so my administrator is probably looking at me like I'm crazy, but my sermon today, hi, Apostle Pierce. How you doing? Amen. You sit between two pretty women and they, amen. Amen. I always call on Elder Pierce, because Pastor Pierce, Elder Pierce. I said, because he makes me work. Because he be like, come on with it, Pastor. Come on. Come on, make it plain. You know. So he makes me work. So sometimes if you see me calling him out and looking at, because he's expecting me to work. He is expecting me to come on with it. Amen. And when somebody have an expectation, when somebody put an expectation on the word, it is something about when you put a demand on God's word that God will make you come on when you don't want to. And the moment I say, you know, I'm just going to get up and talk for about 5 minutes a day, and then somebody put an expectation on God, and then God tells me, this is what you gonna do. So I want to go. Elder Blocker is waiting on me. She is waiting on my theme for the day, Elder Chris. My little, I'm gonna try to work with this today. And Pastor Lawrence, I was looking at him rolling my eyes. I said, now he doesn't know what I'm gonna preach, but he already preached my sermon. He didn't know what I was preaching till I was working on my sermon, and he was doing something else. He said, you got a sermon? I said, mm-hmm, I do. He said, you got your sermon? I said, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Because a lot of times he want me to tell him what I'm going to preach about. I said, we'll see, we'll see. You got a word from the Lord? I said, we'll see, we'll see. So I didn't tell him what I was preaching about. Because I didn't know myself. I didn't know what God wanted to call this. But I want somebody to know I got this from the Lord. I didn't make it up. It's one of my favorite texts, but I have not seen it like I saw it this time. And it's probably going to affect everybody in here. Okay. Because the Lord says, even if you deny it, it's still true. The Lord says, it's time to deal with this post-resurrection fear. My title or the thought that I want to work from is post-resurrection fear. While Jesus was resurrecting from the grave, there was a resurrection of some other things. Resurrection simply means to be brought to life, to live again, to be restored, to be brought back. And so even when you have good, when you have great, when you have wonderful resurrecting, on the other hand, on the other side, there's an opposing force. And is that right? Every time you have a left, most time you got to have a right. Every time you have a good, you most time have an evil. Is that right? And so when we look at resurrection, and though it was Jesus' resurrection, let's say it was Jesus' birthday, and yet there's some other stuff going. You ever had your birthday and then something traumatic happens on your birthday and you're like, oh, Pastor Lord got his hand raised up. I remember, amen, January the 4th, Pastor Lawrence's birthday, and we got a call that his brother just died on your birthday. You're like, Lord. And I remember what my sister-in-law said. She said, I told him, don't die on your birthday. Pastor Lawrence said, he didn't have that kind of choice. So there are times, Apostle, when the best thing happened, okay, when the greatest thing you ever had to happen, we thank God for your birthday, but then here you get a word that somebody died on your birthday. Jesus said, I got up out of the grave, but what else was resurrected in them that was not good? Where were, when I was resurrected, when I was getting up out of the grave, where were they? When I was showing myself to somebody else was afraid. When I was telling Mary who I was, the guards were shaken. They were fearful. Everybody that had an encounter with the Lord on that day had fear. Come on, you can have an encounter with the divine, but the first emotion you have is fear. Oh, I'm gonna help y'all today. And this may take me a couple Sundays to unpack this. Because God says it's a very real emotion. And he wants me to show you in the text that you are no better than his disciples. And so the fear that you will not address, or the fear that you feel that you don't want anybody to know, Jesus said, if you would just admit it's there, I'll deal with you. I'll help you. I'll bring you out. Because when I resurrect, when I got up with all power in my hand. So even though fear raised this ugly head, I have the power to take authority over it. And I've given you the same power. And if you use that power, same anointing, same fear. Let me just read a text there, because I have to set it up. Amen. A scripture that is very familiar, but I want to go to John's Gospel. Told y'all Elder Pierce be putting a demand on me. Where's the word, Pastor? Where you getting this from? How you making that up, Pastor? Come on. Help me with that, Pastor. So John 20th chapter is one of my favorite chapters in the post-resurrection. Before I get there, let me read my text, because I got a lot to say. Amen. St. John 20th. And you can also find this in some of the other gospels like Luke 24. But I want to use John's, because it speaks directly to our hearts this morning. On the evening of the first day of the week, this was still Resurrection Sunday, is that right? This was still on the evening of the first day. So he met Mary in the morning. He met some of the other women. He had an experience on the Emmaus Road. And now it is evening time, and he is with his coming to visit. On the evening of the first day of the week, this is post-resurrection. Post-resurrection means 40 days after the resurrection. Jesus stayed on the earth to give us some lessons in his advancement of the kingdom. It was not enough for us to understand or to know what had happened in pre-resurrection. So then he said, Father, let me stay a little bit longer. Let me help them to understand. Let me remind them of who I am. Let me remind them of what I said. Let them remind them that I am going away, but I'm going to send a comforter. Let me remind them of the power that they operate in. Let me remind, Lord, let me lay my hand on them one more time. Lord, let me be with them one more time. That's the kind of God we serve. We serve a loving God that even when he has saved us, he doesn't leave us. Come on. Even though he has filled us, he doesn't leave us. Even when we don't do what he wants us to do, he still doesn't leave us. Amen. He will always, come on, somebody said, he will always come back to see about you. He will always find you wherever you are. I don't care where you are. He will find you. Somebody said he's going to look for you. Oh, my God. On the evening, that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, I'm reading at the 19th, they were together with the door locked. For my translation said, with the door locked for fear. Is that in your Bible? Yeah, for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw him. What was the first emotion they had? Before they had joy, they had what? Fear. Uh-huh. I just want to make sure Elder Pierce know I'm in the text. Again, Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with this, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sin, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. All right, let's read a little bit further. Now Thomas, this is what I told you, Pastor was trying to preach my scripture. Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples. Amen. So that means it was 10 of them. Judas is gone. He hung himself. Thomas was not there. So he showed himself to 10 disciples in the post-resurrection. And so, with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him what they have seen. We have seen the Lord. Come see. Elder Chris, come see. You can preach that right there. When we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see the nail marks in his hand and put my finger. Come on. You want to do that? You want to see that? Come on. See where the nails were and put my hand into his side. I will not believe it. I don't believe unless I see. Didn't you say, what's the word? Come see. Woo! Elder Chris is going to have fun with that. Come see. Amen. And so Thomas was not present when Jesus showed up. Amen. Come on. Thomas was not present when Jesus showed up. I'm going to throw a bomb. How many of y'all not present when Jesus showed up? How many times you missed the Lord? How many times God showed up where you were and you said, that ain't what it got. No, that ain't God. Come on, the devil is a liar. That ain't God. I'm not saying that. We are not always present when the Lord shows up, because the Lord have a tendency to show up in ways that we are not familiar with. He has a tendency to show up when times when we are not expecting him to show up. You got to learn how to show, let God show up anywhere he is, and you be ready for whatever he's doing. Amen. Thomas was not there, but I love Jesus. Somebody say, I love Jesus. A week later, you know, some of us are a little slow. Oh my God. A week later, his disciples was in the house again. Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, again, what emotions are we invoking? Fear. Why do you lock doors? You afraid that somebody's going to come in, afraid that something's going to happen, afraid that somebody's going to take your stuff. You don't even realize. Elder Chris would say, I ain't scared, Pastor. I lock my door because I don't want nobody walking in. Well, the root of that is you fear somebody coming in while you sleep, taking your life, taking your stuff, stealing your keys, driving your car, taking your bank account, your credit card. And so the reason we lock stuff up, when we go to the hotel, we put our stuff in the safe because we don't want the maid to take our stuff. We don't want, and you may say, ain't no fear, Pastor. What is that rooted in? It's rooted in the fact that I am trying to be safe, but I also know and I hear the news and I realize that everybody's not honest. Everybody's not saved. So I take precaution. Okay, all right. A week later, the doors were locked. Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Mm-hmm. Then he said, Thomas, I love it when the Lord calls us by our name. Thomas, yes. Thomas, yes. Thomas, amen. Huh? Thomas. I know, and you know, you miss movement. So I'm not going to say anything. I'm just going to, Thomas, Thomas. And the Lord can mess you up. I mean, the Lord will mess you up because he will start dealing with you and you'll be like, yes, sir. And I just want to call your name for a moment. Thomas, look, Thomas, put your hand. Put your finger here. See my hand? Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Thomas, come on. Put it right there, Thomas. Put it right there. Come on. See, the Lord says, the reason, I'm blowing Pierce's mouth. The reason the Lord had to have Thomas to put his finger in his side. Sideship represents partnership. Sideship means I have not left your side. I was here. I was with you even though you were not in this place. But put your finger in my side. Come on. Because I need you to know. Don't you find it interesting that Jesus tell Thomas, he said, because I need you to know that even though you were not here, I have not written you off. I have not stopped partnering with you. I am not going to throw you away. Come on, Thomas. Come on. I'm going to let you go a little deeper. I'm going to let you experience something that the rest of them didn't experience, because you got something that's going on inside of you. You got something that's going on inside of you. But I need you to know, if you put your finger in my side, I can heal it. That side anointing. The paraclete, side by side, my partner, the one who will never leave me nor forsake me. Thomas, get introduced to it. Remember, he breathed on the rest of them, and Thomas wasn't there. So now I got to give another expression of Holy Spirit. I'm your partner. Listen, listen. Put your finger here. See my hand. Reach out. Reach out your finger and put it into my side. Then he speaks. Stop doubting. You have touched the divine, and I have activated your faith. Stop doubting, because you have had an experience with the divine. Somebody, I could name this sermon, Stop Doubting, because you have had an experience with the divine. Elder Chris said, I don't know. They can come see. I know what. Come on, somebody. Elder Chris was preaching. I know what he did for me. So I need you to come see what he can do for you. Stop doubting and begin to tell somebody, come see for yourself. I seen it with my own eyes. I experienced him. He is in my, I put my hand in his side. I'm connected to him for like never before. Stop doubting. You have had an experience with the divine. Come on, somebody say, stop doubting. Because you have had an experience with the Almighty. Then Jesus, then after he gives him that reassurance, Thomas said to him, my Lord, my God, I know who you are. Oh, my God. Then Jesus told him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are recorded in this book. I want you to understand. Post-resurrection, I'm not going to be able to finish this. It talks about how this text provides us with a real life issue. Though we are looking at something that took place over 2,000 years ago, it is still relevant for us today. That one of the number one things, two of the number one things I want you to understand, that there is a fear that the enemy has released on the non-believers as well as believers. I know you don't believe this. Then it provide us with some insight that help us to realize that post-resurrection season is a season that fear lurks around and try to find somewhere to launch. Fear is raised up. It comes out of nowhere. And the things that you thought you had dealt with, resurrection, post-resurrection is the time when they resurface. They come back up. And you'll say, I don't know why I feel jittery. Why do I feel this anxiousness? Why do I feel? Because during this season, it's the emotion that's most prevalent, that's going everywhere it can, looking for anyone. The Bible says Satan goes to and fro. Am I in the word? Searching. Is that right? Searching for what? Anyone he can what? Anyone that he can divide. Anyone that I can mess with. Anyone that I can eat up. Anyone that I can deal with. And so none of us are exempted from him, because he looked for an opening and then tried to find. And one of the things that most of us don't realize, that there are some things that deep down in our soul we fear. Oh, y'all don't want to work with me. Okay, come on. Look. It causes us to come back. Fear is, in fact, one of the key. I had to write this down. Fear is, in fact, one of the key factors that will affect us during this season. You see it throughout all of the scriptures. The women were fearful. Remember when the Bible said, go look over in Luke, it says the women were fearful when the angels started talking to them, they fell to their knees. The scripture says the guards were fearful. The disciples were fearful. They behind locked doors. They were separate. Thomas was hiding. They didn't know where he, fear is just running rampant. Fear is the emotion of the event. What? Huh? Most often you will find fear. It was real then and it's real now. We just don't want it. But I like the fact that even though fear showed up, it is not what we look at. They were afraid, but they understood enough. Jesus did not leave them, that fear can be conquered by an intimate relationship with the divine. So everybody that was fearful, that had an encounter with the divine, that fear was taking control. But most of us understand that, look, an intimidating encounter, an intimate encounter with Jesus is the answer to fear every time. Come on, come on. I just gave you the answer. An intimate relationship. If you are fearful of anything, I dare you to get in the presence of the Lord and tell him, talk to him like Thomas did. Lord, I wanted to believe. God, I didn't know what. God, I'm sorry that I was fearful that you left. I was fearful that you was gone. I was fearful that you weren't coming back. I was fearful that they were going to do us like they did you. You got to come to God and begin to tell him what it is that you fear. I know nobody want to shake their head today, but there's something that all of us fear. And when we find that out, when God let us know that, you got to go to God and say, Lord, I didn't know that I still had that fear of death. I still didn't know I had that fear of loneliness. I didn't know I was going to have that fear of losing everything I had. God, I didn't know of that, but I have this fear that I need to talk to you about. An intimate encounter with Jesus. Jesus brings us to a level of intimacy that creates reassurance. He, come on, when you get in God's presence, you are reassured. You begin to operate in authority. You begin to operate in power. You begin to see his love. You begin to see his grace. You begin to see his power. The first thing I want you to remember, look, it is a fact that resurrection, post-resurrection is one of the most fearful times during the year, both for the believers as well as unbelievers. Can you believe that? Wow. We don't want to believe that, but post-resurrection, Elder Chris, create fear. Why? Why? Let me help you. Why? For the non-believer, because they're ignorant. And that means that's not a negative thing. That means a lack of knowledge. Okay, so they don't understand enough to believe, so they question everything. Y'all believe in that Easter stuff? So is it Easter, that resurrection stuff real? They don't know enough, and so they fear what they don't know. They're like, I ain't coming. Do y'all do that? Y'all don't lay your hands on nobody, do y'all? Y'all don't do that crazy stuff in church. See, folks don't know, and so they're fearful. Elder Chris, they're fearful. They're scared. You know, ain't nobody going to be trying to talk to me. Ain't nobody going to say nothing to me. Ain't nobody going to point me out. I mean, there is a fear of coming to church, you know? People will say, I would go to church with you, girl, but I don't do that hocus pocus stuff. That Sunday stuff. No. I'll go another Sunday. And folks will tell me, somebody told me, I don't go to church on Easter. Too many people be in church on Easter. I don't like folks around me like that. That's fear. Lack of knowledge. Don't know what to expect. Don't know enough to make an intelligent decision. Can't see God. Can't experience. Don't have never had that intimate relationship, that encounter. They don't know what to do with all of that. And then I'm going to call out them old people like William Block and Chris Gray that go to church. They say, well, we go to church, Pastor. But we believe, but God, Pastor G, is that really what God's saying? So you fear being deceived. Okay? I hope Pastor G ain't trying to call me today. Because I don't want to give me nowhere. I don't want Pastor Long to be talking about. So we, as a believer, we still fear. Because you're scared somebody going to tell your business. Come on, come on. You scared God going to say, come on. The truth of the matter, no, I don't want to be pulled out in front of nobody. I don't want to come. Pastor, don't call me. Look, if you got something to say to me, call me on the phone, Pastor. Take me off to the side. None of believers fear that we're going to be deceived. They fear of disappointing God. They fear of hearing the wrong thing. They fear of doing the wrong thing. They fear of saying the wrong thing. They feel that everybody's going to be watching them. Everybody's looking at them. Everybody's making fun of them. In your head, the enemy tells you that they are looking at you and making fun at you when God is trying to get something to you. Jesus said, I just want to show up and deal with your fear. Why are you intimidated? Why are you moving from? Why are you running away from me? Why are you hiding from me? What do you have to hide? You can't hide from me. You using all this emotional stuff, trying to hide from an almighty God, trying to keep something. See, you are so afraid that somebody going to find you out. Jesus said, I know that before I go, I need to come speak to this little fear, this little doubt, this little unbelief, this little intimidation, this little anxiousness. I need to come and deal with all of this, because you are not going to be able to advance my kingdom with fear, because fear limits the advancement of God's kingdom. Come on. Come on. Help me, somebody. Fear limits the advancement of God's kingdom. If you are scared, you are not going to do anything. If you are scared, you're going to stay safe. If you are scared, you're going to get behind the locked door and you're not going nowhere. You're not witnessing to nobody. You're not preaching to nobody. You're going to grab your little stuff, go in a hiding place, and you're not. If I want my kingdom to be advanced, I got to come back and deal with this fear. And so God told me today, the reason I'm dealing with this fear is because I want to break that off of you, because your assignment is to advance my kingdom. And if you stay fearful, you will not advance my kingdom. You will not talk to nobody. You will not share your testimony. You will not give nobody a word. You will not tell nobody that I have faults. You will not admit that you are falling short. You will not ever tell anybody that I was a sinner saved by grace, that God grace saved me. I'm afraid you'll find out I'm not perfect. If I start talking about grace, that may, wait. I've been saved all my life. Come on. Oh, no, the truth of the matter, baby, if it had not been for grace, the truth of the matter, none of us are worthy. The truth of the matter, he had to save me like he saved you. I was a wretch undone. I was a liar. I was a cheater. But God came in my life and saved me. I don't care that you know it. I don't care. I'm not afraid that you find out I'm not as good as I look. I clean up well. I'm not fearful that you know that I'm my God. Come on, I did it all right. Jazz, I didn't do it all right. Hallelujah. I wish I had a perfect testimony. I wish I had not made any mistakes. But when I was young, I made a lot of mistakes. But thank God for saving me. Not afraid anymore. I used to be intimidated. And being a woman. I was like, Lord, if you want me to preach, why you ain't make me a man, God? God, why you didn't? God, why you had to do it this way? And God, why everybody want to treat me like that? And why? God said, stop your whining and deal with that mess. And I said, God, I'm scared. He said, what? God, you don't know, God, huh? God, you don't know how cruel this world is. God, what? God, okay, God, I'm scared to preach. Huh? Okay, God, I'm scared they're not going to like me. Okay, God. I'm scared I may misquote a scripture, God. God, I'm scared that they're going to talk about me, God. God said, bring me those fears. Bring me those fears. Whatever they look like, bring them to me so that I can deal with them. Come on, whatever those fears are. I don't know what yours are. I just confess mine. But God says whatever those fears are, you need to bring them to him. God says, because I already know. But what I want you to do is to know that you are afraid. And that those fears, I'm not going to be able to finish that. That those fears came into our life at different seasons. Jesus knew that I got to deal with you now. So, help me, God. Some theologians say that fear is such an emotion. There are at least 365 mentions of fear in Scripture. And some theologians say it's one for every day of the year. And whether we admit it or not, something will intimidate us at least one time a day. Oh, my God. That's a lot. That's a lot that I'm going to be intimidated at least one time a day. Yes. Even if it's nothing, come on, blocker. Even if it's not blocker, spider behind your head, what you going to do? Blocker will come out from behind that stuff back there. I got something to tell the peers. Make sure I tell you something that I got to tell you, because if these brothers don't handle it today, I ain't coming back up in here. Amen. Amen. Hey, God, remind me, I got something to tell you. Amen. Amen. And I need a few brothers to help me, because I told Pastor Lawrence I would do counseling at my house, because I'm not being up in there with nothing else. Amen. That's not the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so that fear shows up in unusual places, in unusual ways, but we got to deal with it. But I want the first thing you need to write down: God did not give us the spirit of fear. Paul says the first thing you need to recognize, somebody say, it's a spirit. I'm going to let that Selah. That's a moment. When I realize something is a spirit, I deal with it differently. As long as I kept it, I'm just a little intimidated of a spider. You know, I'm not scared, but I don't like rats around me. You know, I'm not scared, but you know, I just don't want to be in the same room with one. So as long as I diminish or I reduce that down, that I don't have to fear. If I told you, I know most of y'all don't believe it, the intimidation that comes with me preaching. And how on Sunday morning my body responds. That I have to take authority over my body. That there is such an intent. And I'm not trying to be gross or nothing. But either you're going to find me on my face in prayer, or you're going to find me in the bathroom. Because that intimidation, let's call it that, plays itself out. Make you feel like something is going to happen when nothing is happening. My kid, you looking at me funny, but it'll make you feel like something is going on when you don't have to, you don't really have to go to bathroom, but you feel like you got to go to bathroom. It's not normal, but it's the thing that's coming over you, and it's playing itself out. I start sweating. Pastor Lon said, I told Pastor Lon, I said, I got this jacket on, but I don't know if I'm going to be able to keep this jacket on. I'm so hot. He said, babe, it's chilly. It's chilly outside. I said, but I'm so hot. I'm so hot. I'm so hot. He said, babe, it's chilly outside, and you don't need to go outside. You don't need to respond to what you feel right now. The weather is chilly. You need a jacket on. I'm so hot, King. I want to come out my clothes. I'm like, God says, deal with it. Went back there in the bathroom, Elder Chris. I began to pray. I said, God, this is playing out already, God, and I need you to help me. He says, tell them of the intimidation you feel every Sunday. And tell them you have to take control over their spirit, or it will choke you out and you would not be able to preach. Somebody asked me, why you call people's name? I ain't calling you out. I'm making myself feel comfortable. When I say Jazz, I ain't calling you out. I'm not saying nothing about you. I'm just trying to make myself. I'm just trying to get through it. I'm just trying to seem like somebody's with me. I trust Jazz. Jazz is shaking her head, and Jazz is not walking out on me. And Elder Pierce is okay. I can pick on him. And Pastor Zen is all right. And Elder Chris, no, that's just Pastor G. She ain't calling me and William out. It's just Pastor G. Because that's part of the fear. And until you make it real, until you find a way to get through it, it will limit. Hear me. Y'all want me to preach? Let me call your name. Amen. Because if I don't call your name, it's going to limit. And the enemy will come in, Elder Chris, and wipe my mind. And I'm not able to finish. And I forget scripture. But if I can get me somebody, if I can just look at somebody, and they say, okay, I got you, Pastor. Didi say, I got you, Auntie. I got you. Shanae's back there, Mama, I got your back. If I can just get me somebody to cover me, I can get through what I'm doing. Somebody say that's fear. Shroud in other things. But you have to take authority. Listen, can I just do two? And I'm going to have to come back. Elder Chris, you're going to have to give me another chance. Amen. Couple things. First, y'all already know, 2 Timothy 1:7 says, for God has not given us what? Spirit of. All right. Come on. But he gave us what? A spirit of. So listen to this. Replace. I've already given you a strategy. That spirit of fear with the spirit of power, the spirit of love, and the spirit of. There are your three strategies right there. When fear come in, you know what? I got a spirit of power. Shanda da 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 ba soko. He shanda da 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 ba soko. In the name of Jesus, I cast you down. I declare and decree that you are not welcome in this service. I declare and decree that you're not going to stop the plan of God. I declare and decree that greater is he that is in me than he that is. I'm bigger than you in the name of Jesus, because I have all power because the Almighty has given it to me. And then if he don't want that, say, you know what? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. You know what, Satan? Oh, the reason I don't have to fear you is because the love of God reigns forever. He is love. And since I have him, I have the power of love. And so I replace fear with love. And then if you don't like that one, I got another one for you. You are no longer the father of my mind. My mind has been renewed. Oh, come on. My mind has been transformed. I operate in the mind of Christ, and Christ don't fear you. So if I'm operating in the mind of Christ and Christ don't fear you, why am I fearing you? Have I just given you a strategy? Come on, y'all. Take authority over this thing. Every time that spirit of intimidation comes on you, every time that spirit of anxiousness, every time that spirit of fear of losing, fear of dying, fear of somebody robbing you, fear of being raped, fear of never being married, fear of all of those things, fear that ministry is never going to happen for you, fear that God is going to forget you, fear that God don't love you. Stop allowing the enemy. So, can I give you two things and I'm closing? I want to encourage you to conquer your fears so that you can hear. Come on, say, conquer your fears so you can hear. Fear keeps you from hearing what God is really saying. Yes. Our Father wants to share his heart with us. He wants his children to know what he's doing. Yes. He wants to communicate with you so that you'll be able to be his voice in the earth. Yes. Glory to God. So I got to deal with this fear. Come on, somebody say, I got to deal with this fear. Because I want to hear. Say it again. I got to deal with this fear. Because I want to hear. Do you want to hear? Do you want to know what God is doing? Do you want to know what God is saying? Well, then fear is what's keeping you from hearing. Our Father want to share. He want us to know. He want us to be able to discern. He want us to be able to speak on his behalf. He want us to be his ambassadors. He want to give us a word so that we can share a word. He want us to have a testimony so we can share our testimony, so that we can begin to tell somebody, God, Jesus is still alive. Jesus still saved. Jesus is still a healer. Come on. Jesus is still a deliverer. Come on. You got to hear. God said, I want to deliver that person. And God says, you need to hear that. And if you intimidated because you think they're going to fire you, you won't give them the word that God has for them. God is trying to deliver them, and you are scared that they're going to fire you. You're scared they're going to talk about you. You're scared they're going to call you a Bible thumper. You're scared that they're going to call you a fanatic. Come on. A fanatic doesn't mean just a fanatic for God. You can be a fanatic for football, but if I'm going to be a fanatic for anything, I want to be a fanatic for Christ. We're scared. That's the only place we're scared. Amen. Come on. I ain't messing with y'all brothers, but y'all can stand around for hours. Isn't that right, William? Y'all can stand around for hours. Talking about, man, did you see that? Man, them girls played like, man, them girls played like nothing else. Man, there was more people at the girls' game than had ever been at any of the guys' college game. Y'all could stand and talk about that, and with the wives waiting, and we waiting in the car, and y'all just going. Y'all done lost time. Y'all don't even know. We waiting. We so hungry, and y'all just going. Ah, yeah, man. Man, did you see Caleb Clark? Man, did you see LSU, what they did? Man, I can't believe LSU lost that game. I can't believe. But if we're at the water cooler at work, girl, God moved by his spirit. What? He moved by his spirit on Sunday. He did. Yeah. Shh, shh. Girl, he came in there. He poured out his spirit. Some people got saved. What? Get back to work. Go back to work. We're not talking of that kind of stuff at work. Get to your station. Have you noticed? And it creates a fear in us. So then Elder Chris said, look, man, I'll meet you. Let me talk to you after work. Now, I don't want to get her going. I don't want to get her going. I don't want to get him going. Do you see how? The difference. That is not of God, and that is God, that the enemy will create fear around it. And then it causes us to be anxious. Anxiousness is one of the arms of fear. anxiousness is one of the characteristics of fear. Mm-hmm. It is rooted, one of the words for fear is rooted in anxiousness. It is so much anxiousness in the kingdom of God right now that is rooted in fear. And y'all know the old acronym or whatever they try to say, false evidence appearing what? Real. That's what the enemy is playing on, that he will create false evidence and make it appear real. So somebody can be talking about the weather and it looks like they're talking about you. Somebody can be looking in that direction and they will say, oh, I saw you looking at me. I know when you said that you, don't you say that to me. I'm looking at a certain person and I'm telling them, don't say that to me because I'm just looking in a certain direction. But I have people will tell me, I saw you looking at me when you was preaching that. I said, baby, I didn't even know you was at church. I'm sorry. I hate to say that, but I didn't even, and by Monday I would say, Pastor, was Taylor at church Sunday? He said, yeah, I saw her little girl, so she had to be there. Most of the time, we don't even remember because you don't, because God, when you're up here, God, it's like a blank canvas, and because God don't want me to know, and it's so interesting, I forget stuff. I forget people's name. I was telling Block, I said, girl, I couldn't remember Kiana's name for the life of me. All I could say was Miss Blocker. Y'all didn't know it. I couldn't. For the life of me, I was about to call her Jazz, about to call her Kaylin, and all will come out. God said, you don't need to know, just call her Miss Blocker. Because that's what God is doing. So, listen, this spirit has crept us. I'm getting ready to leave. Jesus knew it will dull your spiritual sense. This is what fear will do. It will hinder you from seeing the move of God. It will cause undue pressure, and then finally, it will cause you to turn back. Can I say that again? It starts with a spiritual dullness. You know, I used to be able to hear God. My inability to see him like I used to see him. I'm not dreaming. I'm not having vision. I'm not seeing what God is. I'm not seeing things through God's eye anymore. See, when we see things through God's eye, it's different. But when fear comes in, we stop seeing things through God's eye. It's the inability to see his movements. We don't see, it seems like, well, church is so boring. God ain't doing nothing. I'd be glad when God come back because he ain't doing nothing. Everybody, no, baby, you just don't see because God is moving. Amen. It causes you undue pressure. You're scared that God is not going to do what he said he's going to do. You're scared that this is the way your life is going to end. You are never going to get out of poverty. You are never going to have your own house. You are never going to have your own car. You are never going to have a good relationship. That's undue pressure. And that pressure eats away and is rooted in fear. And then it causes you to turn back. Fear clouds our vision and keep us from seeing the dynamic thing that the Lord has done. They couldn't see. They couldn't celebrate resurrection because they was too scared. They should have been having a party. Jesus is alive. Jesus is. They were scared. They were scared to make any noise. Fear. Instead of them running through the streets of Jerusalem, he's alive. They were hiding. Fear stopped. And Jesus said, if I don't show up in at least 10 different places, my movement is going to stop. He had to show himself to women, showed himself to two men on the road, had to preach to them, till their hearts burn. Isn't that right? He showed himself to some other women. He showed himself, let Peter them get a glimpse. He just kept, he said, if I don't do this, fear is going to stop my movement. We like to pick on Thomas. But Thomas is the one that give us something to preach about. Because all of them were scared. But Thomas' fear moved him out. So some theologians say Thomas was actually a lot better off, because we tend to believe, most people think he was hiding. They said Thomas was somewhere trying to find some other people. Wow. So I want to give you a different view of Thomas. The rest of them was hiding. Thomas, Chris, Thomas at least was out in the street. We don't know where, Taylor, we don't know what he was doing, but they said Thomas was somewhere doing the work of the Lord. He was saying, I'm not just staying here, because if they come up in here, all of us going to be going. But I'm going to find me another hiding place. And I'm going to take somebody with me. So we don't know. But Thomas made his fear known. So the first thing I want you to do, and I'm closing. Thomas, Romans 10:17. Consequently, faith come by hearing. Come on. So what do I replace? I replace my fear with faith. Faith comes by hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of God, the word of Christ. So I need to replace these fears with some word, some faith. I need to go and find something in the scripture that reminds me of what I'm going through. And that's what I'm going to begin to cry. One word from the Lord can help us conquer this fear. Come on. One word from the Lord can deal with that anxiousness. One word of the Lord can help you to stop putting the pressure on yourself. You don't have to do this on your own. God is not calling you to walk by yourself. God is not calling you to do this journey by yourself. You don't have to fear, because God is with you. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So why are you putting that extra pressure on yourself? Why are you thinking about going back? Why are you thinking about giving up on me when I'm trying to get something to you? Then I want you, Brother Blocker, put Philippians 4, 6 and 7 on the screen. I want everybody, I got a note on my tablet. It says, in this season, this needs to be your favorite scripture in these fearful times. Be anxious for nothing. Come on, somebody. Come on, say, I can't be anxious no more. Come on, come on. Declare, I'm not anxious. Come on, come on, come on. Declare that over yourself. I will not be anxious. Come on, come on. Somebody help me. I will not be anxious. I will not be anxious. I will not be anxious for nothing. God, come on, come on, God. Whatever you show me that I'm anxious for, I'm going to start confessing it. God, I'm anxious over my children. I'm anxious over my marriage. I'm anxious over my finance. I'm anxious over my life. I'm anxious that I'm going to die at 60. I'm anxious. Come on, come on. I'm anxious. I'm anxious. I mean, I will not be anxious for nothing. Oh, somebody, I hear God saying somebody's not believing me. Come on, come on, come on. I need you to confess that I will not be anxious. Come on, say it three times. I will not be anxious. I'm not anxious. God said, I'm going to show you what you're anxious over. I'm going to bring it to your mind. I might not be able to finish this because I feel the anointing of God. God said, I want to break that anxious spirit off of you. I want to come against that anxiousness that is trying to take you out. You are anxious over your life. And God says, your life is not in your hand, but it's in my hand. Yes, says the Lord. I'm anxious over my health. Come on. Come on. God says, I've come that you have life and that more abundantly. Come on. Get shake the anxiousness and say, God, you know what? I'm going to live until you say die, God. And when you say die, I'm going to live again. I'm not anxious. Come on. Don't be anxious about death. Come on. Come on. Come on. Take thought. Come on. Come on. You're going to live again. Come on. Say, I shall live again. Come on. I shall, if I die tonight, I'm going to live eternally with the Lord. I'm not afraid. I'm not intimidated. I don't want to die tonight, but if I die, I live again. Break that intimidation. Come on. Come on, come on, come on. I hear it. I hear God saying, you're scared you're going to die. Come on, come on, come on. Y'all young folks, come on. I may not live as long as Pastor Lawrence, Pastor. I may not live as long as Pastor Zinn. That's not your turn. That's not your time. That's not your decision. It's the decision of the Lord. Don't you be anxious. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Let your requests be made known. Am I right? Yes. To God. God, I'm bringing these fears to you. God, I would like to live to see what you're going to do. But if you don't see fit, let me live every day like it's my last one. Let me live every day serving you so I don't have to be anxious. I'm not trying to work my way to heaven. Come on. I'm saved by grace, right? So I don't have to work my way to heaven. I'm not trying to cross every T and dot every I. I got salvation. I'm forgiven. And that I have a Savior who sits on the right hand of the Father making intercession for me. So I'm not anxious about if I mess up. I got a Savior who had paid the price. If I don't do right, God will bring it back to me and I repent. And if I do wrong, God will say, you are forgiven. My blood was shed for you on Calvary's cross. So I'm not anxious about failing God. I'm not anxious about disappointing God. I'm not anxious that I'm not going to make it into heaven because I'm going to heaven because I've already accepted him as my Savior. I'm not anxious. I'm not fearful. All that foolishness that Satan is feeding our mind. You ain't saved enough. Huh? What's saved enough? You ain't real. Your salvation not real. Well, yours not real. How you gonna tell me what's real? I know him. You don't. Shut up. Go back to the pits of hell from which you came. Send him. Sometimes you just gotta send him back. I don't tell nobody else to go to hell, but you know who I do tell to go to hell? He the only one you need to be telling to go to hell. I don't want nobody else to go to hell but Satan. That's why I don't curse. I don't tell people, you just go to hell. Uh-uh. No, no, the devil is a liar. No. I want you to, no, no, as bad as you are, I want you to go to heaven. As trifling as you are, I'm praying for you to get saved. Come on. Come on, because I don't want hell. I don't want to wish hell on nobody. So if I can say anything to keep you out of hell, that's what I'm saying. Get saved. Instead of going to hell, get saved. You fussing at me? Get saved. Go somewhere and get saved. You don't like me? Go somewhere and get saved. If you got saved, then you will love me. Until you get saved, you can't love me. Okay. Okay, Apostle White gonna get me. Amen. Let me close it. Hebrews 4:16. Write this down. Let us then. Here's how I'm gonna deal with my stuff. This is how I'm gonna deal with my fear. See, I done jumped. I got some more stuff, but I done jumped to give you some strategies. This is how I deal with my fear. Let us then approach the throne of grace. Huh? I got grace. I can use grace. Grace tempers my fear. When I thought about grace is the favor of God that is unmerited. Grace is where God doesn't give me what I deserve. Grace is that God gives me when I don't deserve it. You mean I have that at my, so that calms my fear. Because instead of me operating under fear, I'm operating under grace. Grace is higher. Grace is amazing. Grace is powerful. Grace is given. It's a gift from God. I can't boast in that because it's not mine. So it's God's. And he allows me to operate. Ooh, all of a sudden I feel a little boldness coming on. So I don't have to be intimidated of other people. Grace. They talking about me. Grace. I can't live up to their expectation. Grace. With confidence. Confidence is a replacement for fear. Do you not know one of the key fears that people have is loss of confidence? They don't believe they're confident enough to get up and do that. Yes. They don't believe they're confident enough to wear that. They don't have the confidence. And you know, sometimes that, like, women can relate to that. We say, "Woo, she had to have a lot of confidence to wear that blonde hair. Woo! Girl, I don't have that kind of confidence. Jazz, you got some confidence, girl. I don't have that kind of confidence to put it up there like that with all them blonde colors." And I, you know, so some of us don't have the confidence. And we look at another person and say, that person is operating serious confidence. The Bible says, come through the throne of grace with confidence, knowing that I'm not judged, knowing that it's already taken care of, knowing that great is he that is in me, knowing that he's doing what I can't do. This is the grace. This is the favor. This is the mercy. This is the love that comes back to from God so that we may receive mercy. Wait a minute. Not only do I have mercy, and not only do I have grace, you mean to tell me that God's going to show me mercy too? I don't have to fit. You mean to tell me I don't have to be scared because his mercy? The text shows us that even though Thomas was moved, wasn't there, Jesus showed his mercy, his grace, and his love by coming back a week later and met him right where he is. That's what I want to conclude with. That God says, I want to meet you right where you are. I want to show you grace. I want to show you mercy. I want you to know that the grace that I'm giving you now is for the times when you need help. This is just one strategy to deal with this fear that's been released in this post-resurrection. You don't have to admit it. Some of us know it has reared his ugly head. And there are all kinds of things. If you stop, when you get home, God says, I'm going to show you. Because I didn't read this, Elder Pierce, I didn't read this piece. It says that there are four seasons. I'm concluding. Early childhood. Some people, fear crept in when they were a child. Something happened. See, this is how it sets you up. Something happened as a child. You didn't get something you needed. Something happened. Something scared you. Something caused something to happen as a child. This is where I want you to think. The second time that fear makes a launch is your teen years. Things happen in your teenage years. You're afraid to talk about it, afraid to share, afraid what they called you, how they picked at you at school. things that you, secrets that you had to keep in your teen years. So childhood, teen years. Third time is your young adult lives. It is said that something often happens that set us up, decontaminate, set us up. The fear of losing your husband may have been rooted in your first boyfriend when you was a teenager. And he walked out on you, or she walked out on you. And some of y'all were saying, ooh, I got to think back a few years. But if you go back, and the boyfriend that you thought would be your husband, the girlfriend that you thought would be with you for a lifetime, they're not with you. You're like, Lord, I was 20 and I thought I was in love. God, I was 21 and I just knew that would be my lifetime partner. And that fear creeps in. And say, you can't trust men no more. You can't trust women like that. That girlfriend that you bought everything for, and then she used you and just dumped you in front of somebody. That happens. And we so bad, we get over it. We like, ain't nobody gonna hurt. I don't care. Okay, yeah, but that was the front. But the hurt of that is in my soul. And it set up a mechanism of fear that will rise at any moment. Then they say the most critical time, I'm closing up here, it's the most critical time is in our older years. I'm going to look at some of us older folks. Because they say for us, fear is complicated because we have to deal with dying, leaving things undone. Our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, our legacy. All that we have started, my career, who will forget me? Will they remember me? How am I going to die? Am I going to die of a stroke? Am I going to die of a heart attack? Am I going to die of old age? Am I going to die alone? Am I going to be in a nursing home? Oh, my God, look at all that stuff we got to worry about. Look at all that stuff. And then last, I fear that God, as we get older, we start to say, God, maybe I ain't do enough. God, did I disappoint God? Did I disappoint God? Y'all young folks don't know that we think about that all the time. God, did I witness enough? God, did I give enough? God, do my children know that I love them? God, I will not want to disappoint you. And so it produces a fear. And I find myself being depressed. Because the enemy will tell me, you disappointed God. One of the greatest fears that we have is disappointing God. I know y'all are tired of me, but come on, stand on your feet. I told you that God said it would be heavy. I have asked Elder Blocker just, I don't know if online can hear it, but I asked Elder Blocker to play this song because this song is going to give us the hope that we have.
And I'm going to pray and we'll sing home. Come on, Elder Blocker, let me hear that. That's what I want you to thank. Right now, I'm experiencing some type of fear. And God says, today is the day that he wants to renounce that. He wants you to renounce it. He wants you to break out of those chains. I don't care what kind of pride you have. I don't care how long. I don't care what you think. I don't care who you think you are or what you have done. And all God says, I don't care. There is no one that is exempt from this emotional. I'm no longer willing to be a slave to fear. I will not. There's some things that God wants you to do, and it's going to take boldness. You're going to have to come bold before. But God says, if you would just meet me, if you would just meet me and let me minister to you, you will see that I'm a loving God, that I came back to deal with that in these 40 days. And this is the season that you can take authority. It's all right. The heavens are open. Come on. The heavens are open for you to be healed. The heavens are open for fear to be taken authority over. The heaven, God says, I'm going to open up the windows of heaven. See, we like to use that scripture, but God says, I'm going to pour you out a blessing. I'm going to release my love, my grace. It's going to be like you've never experienced before. Are you willing? Are you willing? Amen. Amen. I want to go down a little bit. I want everybody to repeat this. God gave me a specific prayer over fear. And I want you to repeat this after me. Somebody say, today I stand against the spirit of fear. Y'all not standing. Come on, this is serious business. I I don't need you to just do this because I'm asking you. I need you to get in your mind. Come on, I need you to rear up. I need you to begin to say by power, the authority of God that's given you. Come on, come on, come on. You are a child of God.
You are a child of God. Before I even go any further, come on, stir up the gift that's in you. You are a child of God. I belong to the Lord. Come on, I belong to the Lord. I am bought with a price. Come on, I'm blood washed. Come on, I know who I am. Come on, begin to declare. I decree and declare that I am born again. I know that I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. I know that there's no room for this spirit in me. I know that this is not something that I want to live with. I know that this is something that I want to turn over to God. Come on, if you don't want to do this today, you don't have to. You just sit on down. But for those of us who are tired of being bullied by fear, for those of us who are tired of being intimidated, for those of us who are tired of being anxious, those who are tired and feel like they're causing pressure on themselves, God says, this is for you. This is for you. This is for you. This is for you. Come on, say, today I stand against the spirit of fear. And Satan and his schemes that's coming against my life. Going back and forth in my life from my childhood even to now. I take authority over it in Jesus' name. Come on. I take authority over it in Jesus' name. Going back and forth in the name of Jesus. I take authority over my childhood. I take authority over my teen years. I take authority over my young adult life. I take authority over my old life. I take authority over my life in Jesus' name. Come on, in Jesus' name. Come on, in Jesus' name. What area? What area? God gonna show you what area. When did it come? When did it creep in? When you was a child, I was scared of the dark. When I was a child, I was scared of things. I was scared of boys. I was scared of girls. Whatever God says, when I come against it right now, you're not gonna resurrect that thing in my life. You're not gonna bring it back up again. I am healed. I am delivered. I'm a new creature. Come on. That's the first thing. Come on. You got to deal with all of those times. Huh? Close the door. Close that door. Huh? I closed the door. When I was a child, I was thought as a child. Come on. When I became a man, I put away childish things. I'm leaving that behind. You are not in my life. In the name of Jesus. All right. We got to do a little bit more work. Come on. Say, I curse the root of fear that's trying to grow in my life. Come on, say, I curse the root. Come on. I curse the root of fear. I curse the root of fear. I see myself pulling that root up right now. I see it pulling it up right now. I curse the root. It shall never. I use the power that Jesus used. You will never live again. You will not bear any more fruit. In the name, I curse it. Yeah, come on. I curse the root. Remember when Jesus said, you can use my power. Curse the root. It will never be there. When they see tomorrow morning, when you go to work, they'll say, well, why are you not acting scared? I curse the root of that in the name. It will not produce any more fruit. It will not live again. I curse the root of that that's trying to grow in my life. Come on. I bind every demonic power of fear. Oh, come on. I bind every demonic power of fear. I bind every demonic power of fear. Every demonic power, wherever the enemy has sent it, I bind it up. Every demonic power, whether it's a person, whether it's a situation, whether it's a year, a season, a relation, I bind every demonic power of fear in the name of Jesus. You will not live inside of me. I'm not afraid of being killed. I come against it right now. I'm not afraid of dying. I bind it up right now. It is the die is to live in the name of Jesus. You have made me fearful of death, but I bind that power. Come on. You did that. You did it. You did it. Come on. You bind it. You bind it. No matter where it's coming from. Well, I don't care. I don't care if my mama said it. I don't care if my daddy said it. I don't care if my family, my whole family scared. No, I bind the demonic power of fear. I bind it in the name of Jesus. Then, come on. So now, Lord, let the fire of Holy Spirit destroy every demonic altar of fear. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Let the Holy Spirit, come on. Let the Holy Spirit destroy every demonic altar. Come on, come on. There's an altar that the enemy built up. Every demonic altar of fear that's set up against me, I bind it up. Holy Spirit, burn it up. Burn it up. Holy Spirit, burn it up. In the name of Jesus, every altar of fear that's set up against me, in Jesus' name, Holy Spirit, come on, tell Holy Spirit, burn it up. Burn it up. Burn it up. Destroy every demonic altar. Every altar of fear. Come on, come on. He's built an altar trying to break all that fear. I want the Holy Spirit to destroy in Jesus' name. Lastly, see, this work wears you out. But I'm determined. Say now. Yeah. I speak to the spirit of fear. Say now. Yeah. I speak to the spirit of fear. And command it to release me now. I speak to the spirit of fear. And command you now to release me. Release my mind. Release my body. Release my soul. Release my will. And release my purpose. In Jesus' name, I command you to loose me now. Come on, come on, come on. Y'all like y'all scared. Come on, come on. You're not fearful. You're not fearful. Come on. Take authority of fear. I'm not scared of you. I command you to loose your hold. I'm not intimidated by you. I command. Come on. Come on. Y'all bold. Say I'm bold. I'm not scared of you. I'm not scared of you. Fear, this is the last day that you're going to make me a slave. I'm not a slave of fear anymore. I got one. Oh, God, God, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God. You're breaking chains. You're breaking chains, God. You're breaking chains, God. You're breaking off fear, God. You're breaking us out of that stuff, God. You're tearing down those altars, God. In the name of Jesus. Oh, we are being loose. Come on, come on. I see the chains dropping off of you. I see it all falling off. That childhood is being burnt up. That teen years are being burnt up. That young adult life is being burnt away. Here it is. Here it is. It is. Last piece. This is how we seal this. Come on. Somebody say, Lord. Say, Lord. I receive your finished work of the cross. And I apply it to my life today. In Jesus' name. Fear, you no longer have any control over my life. In Jesus' name. Come on, put your hands together and give God praise. Come on, tell God thank you. Come on and tell God thank you. Tell God thank you. Tell God thank you. Tell God thank you for deliverance. Tell God thank you for deliverance. Tell God thank you for breaking the chains. Thank you for bringing my life back. Thank you for removing that chain off of my neck. Thank you, God. I bless you, God. I praise you, God. Come on, y'all. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord. I'm free. Come on, I will bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord. I didn't know I was in chains. I didn't know I was in bondage. I didn't realize that God would come back and see about me. I promise you, this isn't just something to do today. I knew it wasn't going to be everybody here. I knew a lot of people wouldn't be here. Because God says, this is going to be difficult. He said, but somebody there is going to need that. Somebody there is going to realize. They're going to think back. He said, they're going to think back. And they're going to realize, oh, my God, I didn't even think of that. I didn't even know that. That had to be God. That had to be God. Because that happened to me. And I didn't nobody knew about it, God, but me and you. But that thing has kept me in bondage all my life. But today. You're free. Come on, say, I'm free. I'm free. I can't do nothing else with that. I can't do anything else with that. Bless God. Amen. Elder Block, we off? Amen. Thank God for. We offline. Thank God for. Those who were online, thank God for those, amen, who were online. And I pray that you would go and do the work. Look up the scriptures. I'm not sure if we finished, but God says, I want to break that. He's going to still do the work. Even after we go home, God is still going to be doing the work. God says, I'm going to bring things to you that you forgot. And you're going to, as soon as he bring it to your mind, just close the door and say, I'm delivered from that. I'm a new creature. That's under, come on, somebody say, that's under the blood. That's under the blood. Come on, that's under the blood. And then just go on and give God praise. And we thank God. We look forward to seeing you next time. And there's some more. God said, thank you. Amen. Amen. I bless the Lord. Amen.